equation of motion for my three variables, H, L, C, and which is what I'm doing here. So here we have the Heisenberg equations of motion, and what we have here is thermalization of a harmonic oscillator. So in a way, we talked about it yesterday, just to remind us our equation of motion as written here is L. This is a harmonic oscillator. And LD, I'll write it like that. And LD was K up, if I got it right, X, A, plus K down, and we know to get thermalization, K up divided by K down is e to the power of H bar omega divided by. So this will be our master equation, our quantum master equation, or Lindblad form that we're going to use for the harmonic oscillator. Now what we have to stick here is H, L, and C. And you can see here I've written this in terms of raising and lowering operators. So I have to translate this, we know already, this is A dagger A. This would be A dagger square minus A square, and this would be plus. So we can write these three operators in terms of raising and lowering operators. We stick it into this equation of motion. I let you do this algebra yourself. It's not so difficult to do. And this is what you get. So I wrote it in matrix form. We see the equation of motion HLC, and I added identity because we remember that the Hamiltonian doesn't relax to zero, it relaxes to thermal equilibrium. So that's why we need identity here. So let's see the first equation for just to get a feeling. The change in time, I can write it like that, as expectation value of the energy is minus gamma times H, plus, here I have gamma, and the value of H at equilibrium. So we see that at steady state, or in this case equilibrium also, H will have the value of equilibrium if we go to T infinity, and it will relax exponentially to the thermal state.
What happened to the time becomes of omega?
Now we're thermalizing. So we're in constant omega. This is an isochore. So an auto engine, when you thermalize, you don't change omega. So this is what you, it's an important point that you see, because if we change omega and we have to develop the master equation for a time-dependent Hamiltonian, it's another layer of complication that we avoid. That's why everybody likes auto engine. Because you can do that. You can separate, you can say the work part and the thermalization. So thermalization is pure simple thermalization with constant Hamiltonian. Okay, so what do we see? Here's the solution. The energy relaxes to equilibrium with a certain rate, which is K up minus K down, K down minus K up, and the L and C, you can say, relax to zero, as they should, because in equilibrium they relax to zero, but they oscillate. So they relax at the same rate, but they oscillate with a frequency 2 omega, twice the harmonic frequency. And the reason is, this is a squeeze state. So you have it, if you think about this rotating, it passes this point twice a cycle. So the frequency is 2 times the frequency of the cycle because of this structure. So this is what we get. We get a thermal state relaxing to equilibrium. Now we can calculate the heat. We said Q is expectation value of LD of H. So we see the heat that's absorbed by our engine is this difference, H minus H equilibrium, times the rate. Okay, already here you see something important. You see the rate of heat that you transfer to the engine, this is what you're going to use eventually to get power, depends on this difference. So if H is at equilibrium, no heat will be transferred. So what does it mean? If I want to my engine to work, I want to be outside equilibrium. I want to get power fast. So to get power fast, I have to bring heat as fast as I can. So it means that initially, when I start my thermalization, I want H to be as fast as far as possible from the equilibrium point. So then I'll get more heat into my engine. And I don't want to wait until full thermalization. If I wait, it will take infinite amount of time. Again, I go to my daisies. I don't go to the Lamborghini that I like, you see? So if I want a Lamborghini, I can't wait. I have no patience. I want instant satisfaction. So I want to be far from equilibrium. I'll thermalize. I won't wait for full thermalization. And I'll continue my cycle. This is what you get from here.
Yeah. Well, how long does it take for the cycle to be completed? Where is time?
Okay, here's time appears immediately. Time is here.
Well, but how do you understand the time of completion of the cycle?
Okay, so we did thermalization, but in order to do the full cycle, now I have to allocate time for my 4 strokes. So I have thermalization at the hot side, thermalization at the cold side, and I have to allocate time to my adiabatic strokes.
No, in practically, I mean, if you run the experiment.
That you're running it in your car every day. So that's your RPM. That tells you how fast you're completing the cycle. So you know, somebody who drives the engine, which now people have an indicator, you're driving with fuel efficiency or on. So try to bring your RPM of your engine high. You'll see that there are indicators that you need a new car for that. An old car doesn't have that. You see the indicator, I forgot how, sometimes it's green goes to red. It means you're wasting fuel. So this is a cycle time. The RPM tells you. So I can do a very slow cycle, which you could say I'll reach full equilibration, which will be the most efficient in a way, and I can do a very fast cycle, I'll get less, and this is my choice, but what's nice here, I can see that here, because it's the same equations, I can run, the question is how much time I allocate. Now I want to optimize, I want to have an optimal time allocation, because if I'll give all my time to the hot side, it's also a waste. So you have to balance the time allocation for each stroke. So the car engineers, this is exactly what they do. They design the cylinders and the timing belt in such a way that they allocate at the right time for expansion, compression, and this and that. So a car engineer implicitly does that. But here we have a simple model we can solve in pencil, and we can also do that. And we'll get the same insight. Analytically, this is the advantage of this. So now we have here equations of motion, and now let's look at the adiabats. So, in the adiabats, the Hamiltonian is time dependent. So, the equation I have to write. But on the other hand, I'm not connected to a heat bed. So I don't have to, so my, the equation dx dt is just a commutator with a Hamiltonian plus dx dt. Okay, so now immediately see when my first variable is a Hamiltonian, what I get out of it is only this term, which is a time derivative of my Hamiltonian, which would be here. It will be just proportional to q squared. So if I look, just we'll do this, dhdt will have m 2 omega omega dot divided by 2 q squared. Okay, now what I can do, I want to go back to my original variable, so I can express q squared as a linear combination of L and H. So this is what's written here. And now I did something extra here. I defined something that will be very useful for understanding, and a adiabatic parameter, which is related to, again, what we heard yesterday, if I cross levels or not, how fast I'm going to do my adiabatic move. So the question, adiabatic parameter, basically, it's defined here. It's omega dot divided by omega squared. And this I'll call mu. And this is a very important parameter. Omega is our gap. So the adiabatic parameter says, and it's always the same, that this is the square of the gap, and this is how fast I'm moving. So this is the change in time of my energy levels related to the square of the gap. And you could use this expression not only for the harmonic oscillator in general. You could use the same ideas of a adiabatic parameter. So what does it mean to be adiabatic? I'm very slow on the time scale that's defined by my gap, or really the square of the gap. Now you can see this is dimensionless, this adiabatic parameter. So that's why it's a useful concept. So you can say if it's zero, I'm adiabatic. It means I'm moving very slow relative to a time scale that's defined by the energy difference. So I'm using, again, time-energy relations. So if mu is zero, I'm adiabatic. If mu goes to infinity, I'm sudden. So I can do my engine, depends how I like to drive, press accelerator to the floor, I'm very far from adiabatic, or what I would call in Israel, it's called voye-shvoye. Use this expression. That's from French. This is when you tell your horses to go slow. So in Israel, when you told the horses, you use the French name. Shvoye cheval. From shvoye-shvoye means slow. So here's my adiabatic parameter. And now some algebra leads to these equations, which look very nice. So you see the change in time of h depends on h and l. You can see these two entries in the matrix. If you want to just to translate this, dh dt is, you see, mu h minus mu l, and everything is multiplied by omega. So by moving omega here, I redefined time. Omega dt will be my new time. So I define my time relative to the frequency. Why do I do that? Because on the cold side, the frequency is lower. So it means the time moves slower. The fast and the hot side, the time moves faster. So I'm defining a new time variable, omega dt, or the integral, which we can call theta, which is the integral of omega dt. So omega of t, remember that. Okay, so writing the equations of motion on the diabaticus makes a big simplification. We already kind of get a feeling what's going to happen. If mu is zero, I'm going to stay adiabatic. It means I won't mix H and L. And now we can define power, as we did before, dH dt. And we can see that power has two terms. It's omega times mu times H, the instantaneous value of the energy. And I pay with L. So it means that having the Lagrangian not zero will cost me power. I'll have less power than I would otherwise. So this always works against you. So it means that if I'm adiabatic, or all the time in equilibrium, you can see I have only H, this is zero, this will be maximum efficiency. Generating L, and another way to call L is, this is a coherence. This is a coherence in this case. So generating coherence costs me power or energy. So if you want efficiency, you want to minimize that. And now we can split this term and say we have two terms here. One term is the useful work, and the other term is the friction. This is work that we're going to invest and maybe never get back, because we generated coherence and it's going to be dissipated later. So now we got from this very simple model something that...
You mentioned before that coherence is the expectation value of the A operation.
Okay, so coherence, let's be, the coherence, just to be precise, if we want to be a good definition of coherence, let's call it C like that for coherence, would be L squared plus C squared squared. This would be a proper definition of coherence. Why? Because what is coherence? It's off diagonal elements in the density of it. So L and C don't commute with H. So they describe off-diagonal elements. So their expectation value, I should put your expectation value to be more precise. Their expectation value is the coherence, or the square root. So it's also related to the squeezing parameter. Now, okay, these are for experts. We have an algebra, maybe I'll reach that, and this is what's called the Casimir. So we heard about Casimir, the same guy, he also did some work here.
Ronnie, this is Casimir invariant, right?
This is a Casimir invariant. What is the, yeah, so maybe I'll have that.
Peter Salomon has a...
has a nice paper on it. Yeah. So now, let's solve it. Let's solve the equation of motion.
So why is it not the ordinary harmonic oscillator algebra? Harmonic oscillator
it is.
The harmonic oscillator doesn't have a Casimir.
It does. It's a Heisenberg well. It's non-compact group, but it has a Casimir.
I haven't seen this before.
What? Okay, what is a Casimir? It's an operator that commutes with all operators in the algebra. So this does.
And it's not a constant.
It is a constant of motion, yeah. Sure. If it commutes with all... So the expectation value of the Casimir is a constant. This immediately has consequences. So you say if I change energy, I pay with coherence. Because I have a... The Casimir has a minus sign between energy and the rest. So we can understand this from an algebraic point of view. Maybe I'll go back to that. Okay, so now let's see a miracle. Usually, to solve time-dependent problems is very hard. But look at this equation. If I say that mu is constant, it's time-independent, because I took all my time and put it out here. So if I say mu is constant at adiabatic speed, this is how I'm going to run my engine. So I go to my car engineers and say, listen, engineer my car to be constant at adiabatic speed. In a way, it's optimum for some reasons. Then this mu here, or here, is time independent. And then I just have to diagonalize this matrix. So I solved it. So it means this equation of motion have analytical solutions. Here they are. For constant adiabatic speed, this is the propagator. So I can write the propagator as a product of two propagators, U1 and U2. This is what we do here. And U1 is just a scaling. Because you can say if I expand my energy scale, omega is my energy scale. So you ask how much things change. First of all, they change by the scale. So this is just this omega c divided by omega h. So this, you could say this propagator is trivial. I expanded, so my energy scale went up, and I compressed, so energy scale goes down. So my propagator has this part, which is just a compression ratio, and it has the other part, which mixes everything. So U2 has this form, and you can see it has some oscillations. Okay, depends on these parameters. And it has, you can say, interesting dynamics, which depends on my timing. Because you can say everything eventually depends on the time. Here, this theta appears here, and this theta we defined over there. Is this time. So the question is, how do I define the time of my cycle will determine my propagator. And now, let's look at this entry. This entry, we can call it U211, this is the energy. The first one was energy. Let's go back a minute. The first entry here is energy towards energy. So it means a change in energy depending on energy. If this thing will be one, we didn't generate coherence. This is the best we can get. So in a way, we want this term here to be as close as possible to one, and then we'll get our propagator will look like that. We'll look diagonal. It will have U2, and this will be diagonal, and then we won't generate coherence. This would be the best. This would be equivalent to an adiabatic solution. We are not generating coherence. So, in a way, this is a miracle. It doesn't, you can say it's a solution that you can find for a harmonic oscillator, and we can call that frictionless, because it didn't generate coherence. It was able to move in finite time, an adiabatic expansion, without generating coherence.
Is it possible to have this expectation of L to be negative?
L? Yes.
It may not be for friction.
Yeah, but it's L square always. It's a square of that. L itself can be positive and negative, also C. But what matters is always L square and C square. So they're not negative. So. Okay, so what does it mean? That there are solutions for the harmonic oscillator, which you can do an adiabatic expansion in finite time and not pay at all. You won't generate coherence.
May I see the power expression in the previous slide? So H minus L, is that L?
You can say this is the coherence here.
But it contributes with H minus L to the power.
Yeah, OK. Okay, but this goes against you. This depends if the things. If you look, there will be a difference between the expansion adiabat or the. So it always works against you.
Why do you use the identity part of the
You don't need that. Just to be consistent with what I did with thermalization. So I put four operators, but you can say it's 0, 0, nothing happened. Your identity didn't change. Okay, so why does this happen? It's only at certain times, because this depends on this. You can say when mu is smaller than 2, this hyperbolic cosine becomes cosine and sine. So it's written like that. So mu equal 2 is a critical point. So if mu is smaller than 2, so then we get oscillating type of solutions. What does it mean? That we're generating coherence, but we're caching on it. All what we care is in the beginning and the end to be adiabatic. So we're not adiabatic all the time. It's not an adiabatic solution. So these types of solutions are called shortcut to adiabaticity. And it has been explored. There are many papers on that by Muga Gonzalez and his group in Bilbao. So if you want to know more about this, you can look at papers which come out of the title Shortcut to Adiabaticity. So what is happening here? It's not an adiabatic solution. A adiabatic solution is mu equals 0 or close to 0. It's a solution that initially I'm diagonal in energy, at the end I'm diagonal in energy, and in the middle I have coherence. So I'm using the coherence to cancel itself. You can say in a way, coherence is squeezing this type of behavior. So what I'm doing, I'm waiting until it finishes a full cycle. And then I start like that, I go through states like that, and I end in a situation like that. So it's very delicate timing to what I call cash on the coherence. So I'm investing work, but I'm getting it back. So then there's an issue, how much, if I have to account for that or not. Because you can say I'm investing, doing my adiabatic moves, but I'm getting it back. I have to invest more work during this than I would do it if I would do it adiabatically, but I get it back. So it's like a catalyst. I have something, I use it, and I get it back, or flywheel or something like that. There is a resource here that's needed to get this solution. I think you shouldn't account for it. Eric Lutz has a paper where he says you should account for it. This is typical arguments in the literature, which are good, because it means you sharpen your ideas. Okay, so now we have a propagator. This I'll skip. And just to show, this is a realization of the harmonic engine. I think we saw this yesterday. So the harmonic engine has been realized by one single ion, which is sitting here, in an ion trap which has this shape. Why does it have this shape? Because if the ion moves from left to right, it sees a different frequency. So by shuttling, like if the ion is shuttling like that, it does exactly what we do. It changes the frequency of the harmonic trap. So they shuttle back and forth, and here you can see these pictures. Okay, they drew them in the opposite direction that I went. Here's the cold side, they heat it up, they do expansion, they cool, and they close the cycle. So here is a realization of an autocycle, a single ion in a trap. Why is this important? Because you can say, do I need an ensemble? You can say, in a way, no. If you average on a single realization of one ion, You can look at the noise here that you get. You get quite a good description of this auto cycle. So you can say this is nice for me because it said that thermodynamics goes all the way down to a single level of one ion in a trap. Okay, maybe I'll stop here. It's a good place to stop. And we'll continue after we have some
questions.
Yeah, what questions?
What happens when mu is greater than 2?
Okay, this is a good question. So, first of all, you could ask what happens at 2.
Yes.
If you look at 2 exactly, this matrix that I wrote is not diagonalizable. So, you get what's called the Jordan block. And this is called an exceptional point. The eigenvalues of the propagator become degenerate at that point. But it's this propagator is non-Hermitian. So we get a non-Hermitian degeneracy, and which is sometimes called an exceptional point. And what is happening there that the solutions change, it's like I wouldn't call it a phase transition, but it's a critical point. You can say we move from cosine to hyperbolic cosine. So you can say, if you want the best analogy, we move from a damped harmonic oscillator to an overdamped harmonic oscillator. This is this point. So we get to overdamped type solutions. The engine will still work, but we'll move towards a sudden limit. So it will work in a different way. But it still can work. The sudden engine can work. Can produce power, it's very irreversible, and but it still can work.
Okay, one more question. You said that when mu is smaller than 2, we have shortcuts to adiabaticity.
Yeah.
And then, we have adiabatic in the beginning, adiabatic in the end, but during the process, we have to pay for the coherence and stuff.
Yeah.
Can we do it by not paying? By just connecting this harmonic oscillator to a dephasing path, for example, in order to get rid of the coherence during.
That's bad.
Okay. Why?
It's a very important point what you're saying, and it's delicate. Because if you look at it, what does it do to add dephasing? You can do that.
Pure dephasing. What,
yeah, we're talking about pure dephasing. Pure dephasing will project on energy. This is what we want, so it won't generate coherence. So you would think this should help. Yeah, so there's even a way to do that. One way to do that, you can say my changing omega with time is I do it in a scheduler. So I'm an engineer and I want to design my car. So this is time, and I know I want to follow a certain profile. This is a profile of omega of t. So as an engineer, I have a kind of a step motor, and you can say in discrete times, this is t1 and t2, I change like that. If I'll do that, I'll get amplitude noise. This is because this type of operation won't commute with the Hamiltonian, because what I'm changing is Q, the omega, the part. But if I try to do it differently, I'll try to really follow as much as I can. But I'll do it in random intervals. So this will be T1, and this delta T1, and this will be delta T2, and so on. I'll do it like that, and like that, and I'll try to follow as close as possible this, but my timing will be random. This will generate pure dephasing, because my propagator is e to the power of iht, and this delta t is random, so it's equivalent to what I described yesterday of a Hamiltonian that has, you can say, a constant and h times f of t, where this f of t is delta coordinate. So this will generate pure diffeasing. So this is what you want. Okay, but now what's the difficulty? In first order, it looks okay. But in second order, the Hamiltonian doesn't commute with itself. So if you look at the influence of this at second order perturbation theory, you see that this is bad. It will generate noise and will kill your adiabatic system.
Only how can something cannot commute with itself?
The Hamiltonian at different times.
Ah, okay.
H of t, h of t prime, okay, don't commute. Because you change. So you're, in a way, we're playing with time ordering here.
Yes.
So that's why it's more delicate than you would think. So it's at certain instances maybe will help a little bit, but in general, if you want to work fast, it's against you. In the adiabatic limit, it could help a little bit. I would call that lubrication when things are slow.
What I had in mind was that not playing with the times of change of this omega t, but adding an external
bath. Yeah, but your bath has to measure your energy.
Yes.
So you could externally say I want to collapse, measure energy or some weak. But the trouble about that your energy operator is changing in time. So when you have to change your, if you think about like that, you have to change your measurement while you follow the trajectory. So what I suggested here is a way to do that, not directly, but indirectly by changing time intervals. So the idea is you can be done. You can generate noise, defacing, pure defacing noise on the adiabat, and the influence on the dynamics can be calculated. In general, it doesn't help. But could be instances. The instances when mu is small, it does help. So that's why it doesn't help you to move. For your Lamborghini, forget it. For your daisies, maybe you add that. You buy this device, you save some fuel.
Another idea is to add some terms, which are
yeah, you could. Okay, so in all the study of what I would call shortcut to adiabaticity, you can add to your Hamiltonians what's called counter adiabatic terms to try to correct for that. All these tricks work when you have a closed algebra, so you can add. But then I add something to my Hamiltonian. I pay for it because I add them, but then I want to get them away. So in a way, you could say I could do the same thing with mu constant in different ways. It's not the only way to get shortcuts. I would say it's a good way to explain it because we can see how you get a shortcut out of the solution. But when you study the possibilities making shortcuts, there are many possibilities that you can do with it. The optimal ones are bang bang, which are aesthetically not nice. But they're the optimal if you want to really go through this exercise. Yeah, more questions before our coffee? Okay, so let's stop here.